I'm the Silver Fox and we're at the Pathfinder gathering. So I'm in Ohio and I'm out with Chance Sanders today.
What's going on, guys?
Or Chance, if you're American, but Chance in England. And basically he's going to show us some traps, basically. So hand it over to you, please, mate.
Alright, we got a basic spring pole here. We got our bank line coming down, a toggle. We've got our fork in the ground and we have another stake here. About, I don't know, 8 inches off from our fork here. And this is our trail. This is our line of movement for the animal. Now you can use this as a bait stick. And like I say, you have any kind of guts or something like that, you can wrap around the stick. And what you're gonna do is bring your toggle down, go underneath of the fork here, but you gotta make sure that your loop, the part that's actually going to catch the animal, stays on the outside. It's just the toggle that's going in.
Okay.
All right, and you get your other stick here. And you're going to wedge the stick, the toggle stick against the post out here. You got to kind of work with it. You want it to be really just like almost ready to go off when you're doing this, so. Now, we're going to take our trailing end of our bank line there. We've already tied a loop in it, and then we pulled the bank line through the loop, making a noose. And that, we're going to lay over the top.
Okay.
All right?
Yep.
So, you want that loop to stay open. The good thing about bank line, once you kind of make your loop, It'll hold that form because it's tarred, and it'll keep that loop you want there. And if not, you can always take, you know, those little sticks or something and kind of peg it out. But, you know, the animal comes along, he's messing with your bait stick, and now you've caught him. That's one variation. That type is normally used if you have, some type of bait to put on this thing.
The advantage of this type of spring snare is because you've got predators.
Yes.
Because very often our snares are just staked into the ground.
Yes.
On a rabbit run.
Right.
But we have foxes around, but you obviously have far more predators than we do.
Right, yeah, definitely something, this will be, you know, any type of predator, raccoon, possum, anything that's gonna eat meat is gonna be attracted to the smell, they're gonna come mess with it, and hopefully you're gonna catch something like that. Yeah. Now, for animals that are not predators, we have a couple other traps. They're the same thing, just a variation of it. What you can do, find the right length of stick here. Look at that.
For your nephew.
So we just take a stake, our same fork is here. Take a stake and come and drive it down in the back side of our fork there. And we're gonna bring this down, come around, and lock it into place. Wedge it up against this there we go.
Now, all right, okay.
Once again, we took just a toggle and went underneath the fork. Our loop's going to be coming back out. The loop, I don't know if you can see it or not, we're gonna place right underneath this stick. And on the end of this, if we had berries or something like that that we could, you know, a piece of candy bar or something you had left, trail mix or something. Not trail mix, but some type of bar you can stick on the end of it, peanut butter, whatever you got. And they're gonna come, they're gonna be messing with this. And we're gonna readjust our trap. I don't know what happened there.
So we just do it again, we'll re-edit it.
Yeah.
Now that caught up before, didn't it?
Yeah.
Now I wonder, is it because you got the...
I think the stick's too long.
Well, I was going to say, if you had it off-centered, would that make a difference? Rather than have the stick in the middle of... I'm asking a question, by the way.
Yeah, no, I'm trying to figure it out right now.
All right.
Like I said, I just learned this one yesterday. Dave showed it to me, so...
Okay.
Haven't had time really to play with it.
Okay. Actually, I don't know it, so...
But when it works, it's really good.
Because the only spring snare I've ever used is when you get sort of one stick...
Right.
And you have a... you'd sort of cut a notch into either one, so you have one in the ground, this one's attached to the bank line.
Right.
That's the only one I've ever used. I've never used anything like this.
Alright, so here we are again. We have our noose there, and hopefully there we go.
Right.
They touch the end of it, they go reach up to get whatever's on there, and boom, he's caught.
So that would snag him by their legs more than likely.
Legs or head, or he could, you know, come up underneath his armpits,
mm-hmm.
or around his neck if he just had his neck in there messing. But
yep.
He's gonna have to be either big enough to touch it with his mouth, mm-hmm. or have to be standing inside of it, reaching and messing with it.
Mm-hmm.
So a squirrel or something like that, you'd probably get him around the neck or underneath the armpits. So that's two variations of a baited trap. The third variation would be actually taking it. You're gonna come under here. You know, same principle,
mm-hmm.
only the toggle goes through. You have another stick back here. That holds it into place. Then you take a stick from here to here. I'll make one longer. Let's see. This is one. One across. Like this. And then what you can do, and this is just on a run, you can dig it out underneath where this is just flat and they step into it. But it's a treadle trap. And all they gotta do is walk on it. So if you were, well, put your sticks up there. And you can funnel the animal in. You know, you want basically a bunch of stakes in mm-hmm. the ground so he has to walk over
right,
your trap.
Okay, yep.
So we got that, and we got our noose.
Mm-hmm.
And if this thing works the way it should, is the animal presses down on here, and it catches it. Now, you'd want to make those sticks more uniform,
uh-huh.
because you don't want him stepping on a stick that's out here and setting off the trap before he's even got into the noose.
Uh-huh, yeah.
So it's critical that these are all, you know, a uniform size. And you can do it, you know, on both sides. That way you can, no matter which way he comes from, you just stagger him, you know, so he'll have to step on it.
Yep, okay.
Either way. So that one is not dependent on any type of bait. And the last one is a little bit harder to do, but it has a lot of merit, I think, called the dinner plate. You basically take a piece of bark or something and put it underneath your hook or underneath your fork. And then you're gonna need, your toggle is gonna need to be a little bit longer, or you need to move your string over to one side a little more. And this one is gonna go through the back and come over the top. So, let's see. Something like this. And, you know, let's say you found some kind of nuts or something. It's, you know, it's hard to secure a nut to the
mm-hmm.
end of a stick.
Yeah, say that's our nut.
So, yeah, let's say this is our nut, or, you know, piece of something we found out in the woods, a nut or whatever. We're going to bring this up through the back side, and we're going to stick our stick on top of this nut. And this is actually kind of hard to do with one hand, so I'm going to take that off. Hold it here. Get a hold of that again, and then pull. Well,
it almost seems to be like the harder they are to set, the more effective they are.
Yeah, for sure. Because if something's easy to set up, that means it's not very sensitive. You know, the more sensitive it is, the harder it is going to be to set. But it's also easier it is. The easier it is for you to set it off, the easier it is for the animal too. This is one. We have to do a little doctoring to our stick here, but that's no problem. Alright, we're going around the back, coming around the front. Oh, one thing I left out. You're gonna want to make sure your noose is around that before you put the stick down. We got our noose there.
Okay, yeah.
We got our bait.
Yep. So noose goes, so the bait goes in the middle of the noose.
Yep.
Or the dinner plate.
Yep. That comes around from behind.
Mm-hmm. And obviously watch out for your face when you're setting that.
Definitely. And depending on the type of fork you have in the ground, you're going to have to move this around so it's sitting up. It's going to want to take the path of least resistance. Alright, so now,
you've
got it set up. It's sensitive. And the good thing about it is even if them, like, going after the food doesn't set it off, once they start to degrade that nut or whatever underneath it, is underneath it, it's going to set it off. But, you know, ideally, they're in here messing with it. They're trying to eat. No, it missed my hand, but it definitely would have gotten it. I guess I got a little shy of the thing. Jerk my hand back out of the way. So that's it. That's four different types of traps. All off the same system, the same pole, same toggle. And this is, you know, Dave teaches this, which is obviously where I learned it from. And, you know, you got the fork. Some people have different kind of soil, if it's sandy soil or if it's you know, really wet, kind of boggy soil.
Mm-hmm.
What you can actually do, and I'll do a small version of it, one of these vines here, I guess, but take your green sapling and you can form a hoop in it and bury the hoop to where there's just the bow sticking up out of the ground.
Right.
And then that's what you can use for this piece here.
Okay, yeah, yeah.
Some people say that you can just drive two stakes in the ground and tie it off. You can do that for some of them, but the way we're working the toggle back under here on a couple of those traps, it's not gonna have the same resistance because this is a step down and it
wouldn't
necessarily work as good. Exposed roots, if you happen to be in an area that has exposed roots, like mm-hmm. on riverbanks and stuff, those can work as well. So you're not limited. But the good thing about it is you've got four variations working off the same system. So it's easy, you know, it's pretty easy to remember. And it takes practice, you know, you saw messing around here, but it takes practice to get these things down, and as you do it, you'll get better at spotting the exact dimensions of things that you want to use.
Yep.
And you know, how you set them up and where you set them up and stuff.
Fantastic.
Awesome. Well,
excellent.
Cool.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, man. Important part of this is that we are taking this bait stick and we're actually digging it, driving it into the ground behind our fork. That way it's only moving down and it moves out of the way and doesn't get hung up behind here. We have a toggle on the back that's attached to this cord running up to our spring pole. You know, it's a sapling we cut the top out of it nice and strong, got a lot of tension on it. And you want to make sure you cut the sapling off and don't leave a bunch of branches, because those branches are going to slow down all that mass, and leaves are going to slow down the movement of it popping back up. You know, ideally we have some kind of bait here on the end, because that's what the animal is going to come for. It's going to play with this bait and move my head out of the way. And so he's playing with the bait there, and you got him.
Wow. That's a fast trigger.
That's a very fast trigger. It's going to get him up off the ground so he can't be digging and stuff like that. And he's going to be hopefully suspended up in there a pretty good bit. And that's just, that's the variation of this toggle spring system.
And this bank line, as opposed to like the snare wire that we would use back home, the snare wire is obviously very silver.
Yes.
And it would stand out. That bank line being black and waxed, just seems to, you can't even see it on the ground at all.
Yeah, it pretty much disappears right into the ground.
Hmm.
And it's tarred, so if you have to leave it out there for a little while, I mean, it's, you're not going to rot or anything because
yeah.
It's tarred bank line.
Yeah.
It holds pretty much just like your snare wire does. You know, it'll hold a loop really good because it's waxed.
Yep.
And I like it because it's got more uses. I mean, snare wire is good, but if you're going to set 20 or 30 traps, I mean, how much snare wire do you really carry? And a lot of your smaller kits, you know, they may have 5 feet of snare wire.
Yeah.
What's that, two snares maybe?
If you're
and then,
lucky.
You know, trapping's all about increases your chances, increasing the odds and setting out a bunch of snares and traps. But when it comes to remembering traps, you know, you got one system here that you can employ in four different ways.
Yeah.
And more than that, it's just, this is the four we demonstrated.
So in theory, you as a person out in a self-reliant situation, you've got that one system and then you can then use that one trap for four different situations, scenarios.
Yes. Yes.
So if you've got limited resources on bait, for example, you know, you could put the treadle one through.
Right.
So you might be able to set up, say, three for bait sticks.
Yep.
And then, I don't know, half a dozen other treadle types.
Yep. You could do, you know, as many as you can. You can even do it with just the first one I showed where you would normally have bait and you just didn't have any bait. It's just something they would run into.
Oh, you know, okay, yeah.
If you funnel them into it, they just hit the stick, you know, step on the stick or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, if you're going to use it that way, and even with the trail, you want to have your toggle, and you want to have this down lower to the ground, so it's, you know, just right above the ground. You don't want them to have to hop up on it. Another thing that I've been taught is if you have something you want them to put their foot in a specific spot, you put something they have to step over.
Oh, right.
In front
yeah.
of it.
Mm-hmm.
That way he's got to go over it and then his feet are like off, you're going to land right there.